Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
You're all very, very welcome. It will be interesting at the end of the night to do a head count or a count of all the seats. I think it could be a record attendance. And we know you're all here to welcome our local man who has travelled the whole way from Belfast to be with us, and we're all looking forward to what he has to say about traditions and marriage and dowries and land and everything in our county in the past. So a warm Tipperary welcome to our local man, Liam Kennedy.
Thank you very much, Mary, and I'm delighted to be here. It's a great honour to be asked to give a talk. I've realised I've met perhaps more relatives, neighbours, friends in the last 20 minutes than I've met since the last big funeral in Borrisoleigh. So I don't know whether that's a good omen or not. Anyhow, I'm delighted to come along. Now, when I was invited to give the talk, this was last summer or whatever, for Mary and others, I was reasonably confident we'd be celebrating another All-Ireland victory. It wasn't to be, but they blow a leg of work for that. And now, there's something that's changed in the sporting world, and since tonight's talk is quite a bit about change, it's perhaps worth noting, sticking with the hurling image for a moment. When I was going to my first matches in the early 1960s, the perennial enemy was Cork. Those were the days of Jimmy Doyle, Tony Wall, Tony Redden, and the fullback line that was referred to colourfully as Hell's Kitchen. Bowley Michael Maher and company. And then there was Jimmy Finn and Liam Devaney from Borrisoleigh. I think Sean Kenny had retired by that time. And incidentally, I did manage to see one of the last games of the great Christy Ring, with blood streaming down one side of his face. He actually comes into the talk later on as well. Anyhow, the watchword at the time was Hay Saved and Cork Bet. Yeah. But in recent decades, an even more formidable enemy has emerged on the banks of the Norse, the nemesis of Tipperary in the last decade, indeed more, has been Kilkenny, while Cork has declined as hurling power. Which, I suppose, is a kind of illustration of issues of change, that nothing is forever in this life. But who knows about 2015? I should also say I'm feeling a little bit tense about giving this talk. It's the first time ever I've talked publicly about Borrisoleigh. And there are people here who know a lot more about the parish, the history of the parish and so on, than I do. And in that sense, and that isn't a problem, but I would prefer to be listening to them rather than myself blathering on. So I hope we have plenty of time for discussion at the end. Incidentally, a few people have to leave at 8, so by all means, feel free to do that. Now, maybe a few preliminary comments. We're talking about contemporary history, or near contemporary history, you know, really on the edge of living memory or a little bit beyond that. So, you know, there are on many issues, as many viewpoints as there are people. And maybe I should also say that, you know, I suppose history writing in relation to a parish or a county or a nation, whatever, isn't about celebration. I mean, some, but not all of it, in the past is worthy of celebration. So the historian's enterprise is perhaps a bit different from other kinds of writers. It's about recalling elements of the past, analysing them, making connections, developing interpretations. So I suppose my approach is, in writing history, is it's a case of what's and all. And given this is the first time I've done a talk on Borrisoleigh, which preeminently deserves to be talked about, and I hope to underline that point as we illustrate that point as we go along. So I'm inclined to think of this as an experimental piece which maps out possibilities for research rather than being a definitive set of findings. And I want to place Borrisoleigh, and it could be Temple Derry or Upper Church or Drum or Ballycannon, in a larger context. That is, debates about rural Ireland, and in particular, debates about the decline of rural Ireland in the 20th century. Because when I was growing up, and I was talking to Michael Stapleton just beforehand, and we're both recalling that in a sense we both left Borrisoleigh and boarding school by 1960. So I'm coming back after an extremely long time, it's more than 5 decades. Anyhow, many of you will recollect some of the tenor, the atmosphere of the 1950s. When giving talks to students in Belfast, the Queens in Belfast, on the 20th century, I sometimes hold up a yellowing copy of my father's economic development, the T.K. Whittaker document, Economic Development, which is said to have launched an Irish economic revolution. I don't actually subscribe to that view, but it certainly was a hugely influential and important publication. But in that, Whittaker and his co-authors talk about an air of despondency in the small towns and rural areas of Ireland, and the need for radical change in economic and social policy. If you think also of another official publication, the Commission on Emigration and Other Population Problems, that commission sat between 1948 and 1954. And naturally, it saw emigration as a great national problem. And I can find the page quickly. And then notes on this. Yeah, the commission, it's a very large publication, a funny one. And amongst its observations, it says there's something gravely wrong in a community where there is such a widespread frustration of a natural expectation. And in our considered view, the low marriage rate is one of our two great population problems, the other being, of course, emigration. And the Commission went on to blame economic underdevelopment, rising expectations of material living standards, and in rural Ireland, a late age of inheritance as the primary cause of poor marriage patterns. Can I just check? Can everyone hear me round? Is okay? Good, thank you. And, you know, thinking of the 1950s, that was the decade of the greatest exodus of Irish people since the 1880s and the land war, and so on. 400,000 people, mainly young people, emigrated from Ireland to Britain in the 1950s. So it was a massive exodus, a hemorrhaging of the lifeblood of the nation. So there was cause for real concern. And then in terms of the development of the literature of rural Ireland, you have in the 1960s and the 1970s a whole series of social anthropological accounts of life in rural Ireland. Now, one of my criticisms of that literature is that there is a kind of fatal fascination with the west of Ireland. Something shared by writers as well, I would argue. And creative writers, I mean. But anyhow, if you think of some of the key books, there's Hugh Brody's Inish Killane, subtitle is Change and Decline in West Ireland. I don't know if many people, anyone read Inish Killane? Beautifully written book, short, it's out of Penguin or Pelican. It's out of print now, which is sometimes getting in second-hand bookshops. And Brody argued that what he was observing along the western seaboard widespread demoralisation of communities. So you have emigration, migration, late age of marriage, low frequency of marriage, and anomie, people being demoralised. We also had John Healy, writer with the Irish Times, who wrote a book, No One Shouted Stop, about Charlestown, County Mayo. Sometimes wondered, you know, if somebody had shouted stop, would it have made any difference? But rather similar themes about almost inevitable decline, disintegration of rural communities. I hear Robin Fox, participant observer on Tory Island, very similar story, a bit more nuanced perhaps. And then to cap it all, Nancy Shepherd Hughes, an American social anthropologist, who proclaimed rural Ireland was dying. The title of her book's interesting in itself. It's called Saints, Sinners and Schizophrenics. I think we all knew we were saints and we were sinners, but the schizophrenics was a little bit hard to take. She was studying a community halfway up Mount Brandon and arguing that there was an exceptionally high incidence of mental illness. I don't know. I've never been there, and I certainly wouldn't want to generalise from a village and surrounding area halfway up a mountain to rural Ireland as a whole. So that whole literature, which has some really important insights into rural Ireland and into social change in Ireland, at the end of the day, thinking of Borrisoleigh and communities in Tipperary, it just didn't ring true to me. Anyhow, that's the larger context, and we'll return to some of those. So if we could zoom in on Borrisoleigh now. I have to communicate with John on the other side of the room. So Borrisoleigh, yeah, I think we know where we are. Premier County. And then, Belfast, I would say, it's not quite true, but Borrisoleigh is halfway, roughly halfway between Poland and Selina. It's closer to Poland. And indeed, as I was growing up, all the social pools were towards Burns. Burns was the market town. You can see it up there. Temple Moor, in terms of railway connections, is a bit closer. Now, the parish used to be known as Glen Keane. And in the olden times, my daughter always says anything that's more than about 20 years old is 20 years back in time, is the olden times. Anyhow, the olden times, in 1921, it was in Borrisoleigh's and the Pauline Union of Furlers. Incidentally, I don't know if it's still the case, you'll be able to tell me, but when I was growing up, Borrisoleigh Village, which was about 500 or 600 people, it's about 800 people now, was always called the town. Though in reality, it was a village. And it's interesting from, a historian and social scientist point of view that, rather like the neighbouring parish of Temple Derby, Borris Parish has upland and lowland areas, which makes it kind of interesting in terms of developing contrasts between different townlands. In fact, if we look to the next slide, you can see the Silvermine Mountains, really that whole mountain range to the left, to the west of Borrisoleigh, the Schlieffen, we call them mountains, but I guess they are hills, really. So, those hills in the direction of Keeper Hill, Newport and Limerick. And on the other hand, in the neighbourhood of the village of Borris, there's much more low-lying, fertile land, so a mixture of two types of land. Now, I want to begin the social history of the parish or sub-region, now that we know where we are, in the early 20th century. Of course, the great resource we have, which we can lay our hands on easily by the internet, is the 1911 census of Ireland. is actually, this is a townland map of Borrisoleigh, and the civil parish roughly coincides with the Catholic parish, which is quite useful in terms of making comparisons over time. I'm born in Cranvaux, which, oh yes, it must be down about here. It was only when I was looking at this map I realised that we grew up on the periphery of the parish, although never quite felt like that. Anyhow, 1911 census is a fine benchmark. And of course, if you like, says not only to the published census results, but also access via the internet, via National Archives of Ireland, access to much more detailed census forms that each and every household in Ireland filled in 1911. So it's a kind of massive digitizing process. And just to give an idea, if you looked at the first, I'm only going to use one census form, could devote a whole session actually to looking at various census forms. Probably can't read them very easily, so let me just indicate some of the key points there. So you have, can you see it? James Ryan. This is a standard census form filled in by heads of households, typically on census night in 1911. So you have James Ryan, head of family, then it gives religion, Roman Catholic. Then it gives us a column on literacy, read and write. He can read and write, not everybody can. Gives age, another vital variable in terms of reconstructing aspects of the past. He's aged 70, occupation, farmer, he's married. And this was an innovation in the 1911 census. It's not there in 1901, not the preceding December censuses. And that is that in 1911, there was a whole section on fertility. So you have the duration of the marriage, 38 years, which goes through quick arithmetic. You see that if you subtract the duration of marriage from the person's age, you get the age at which they were married. So James was aged 32 when he got married. His wife was aged 30. They had 9 children born, 6 still living. So 1/3 had died. And that's not unusual. We may not have time to talk about this again later on, but child mortality and infant mortality were major killers in this period. And that indeed is one of the massive social changes of the 20th century, the decline in infant and child mortality. One historian says it's one of the great triumphs of 20th century medicine dealing with infectious diseases, particularly those affecting children. According to this census form, and indeed virtually all of the others from Borrisoleigh and elsewhere in Ireland, women had no occupations. So James's wife had no occupations. Should have been so lucky. Or the daughters, similarly. Any of us, those of us who've grown up in rural Tipperary, know that that's absolutely not the case. And that, if anything, women did more work, almost certainly did longer hours than most husbands or sons. They have a son, Patrick Murphy. Sorry, not they have a living in servant, Patrick Murphy, has a 34-year-old son, presumably the heir, and is unmarried, again a fairly typical pattern. But the lack of female occupations is a real, in the 1911 census is marvellous in the London market. It's incredibly helpful. But it is a great pity that there is a gender blind spot, that clear gender bias against picking up on female occupation. connections. But we can fill those in imaginatively, particularly in rural areas. Let me say a little bit about the economy, and then I'll go on to talk a bit more about families and households in the early 20th century. Well, in 1911, incidentally, you could have endless statistics given the sources available to us. I'll try to keep the statistics to a minimum, because they're not always the most palatable. What we really want to get are the broad brush strokes. But for what it's worth, it's just over 400 households in the parish in 1911. More than half of those were farming households, about 55%. Also, a significant stratum of agricultural labourers, labouring households, but 1/6 of the population were agricultural labourers in 1911. And then you've got a whole sprinkling of blacksmiths, coopers, buttermaker, creamery manager, national school teacher, RIC men, nuns, priests, five nuns as I recall, in the convent in Boris, two priests, parish priest and curate, one doctor, and then declining occupations like bootmakers and shoemakers who were just barely hanging on. However, while you have a great variety of occupations at one level, at another level, the dominant social reality is that most people were dependent on agriculture. If you add together the farmers, the farmer households and the agricultural labourer households, you account for 3/4 of the households in the parish. So it's a mixed farming economy, heavily dependent on agriculture. Now, social scientists and perhaps particularly social anthropologists sometimes write about, they know the reality is different, but they sometimes write about small communities as if they were self-enclosed, cut off from the rest of the world, rather exotic places, introverted, and so on. But in fact, Borrisoleigh and other rural parishes of the time were highly oriented towards commercial farming, plugged into, via cattle traders and grain merchants and so on, plugged into international markets, particularly the British food market, which was a major destination for Irish foodstuffs. So this is a commercialized economy. It's not a self-subsistence economy at all. So the prices that ruled in London, fairly quickly relayed back to London being like an international food market, those prices very quickly relayed back to places like Borrisoleigh. And of course you have the railway connections at Perlis and Temple Moor. The other point to make, I mentioned agricultural labourers. There's a very good article by the historian David Fitzpatrick on the disappearance of the Irish agricultural labourer between 1850 and 1914. In terms of places like Borrisoleigh and actually many other commercial farming areas, it's partly true. The numbers of agricultural labourers are falling in all decades from the Great Famine onwards, down to 1911. There's still significant numbers of farm labourers, agricultural labourers, workmen, whatever terms you want to use, in 1911. And that really persists into the 1950s, although the numbers are falling all the time, but you still have in Borrisoleigh in the 1950s, farm labourers. Now, sometimes it's only part of the life cycle. Young men, typically young men, aged 15, 16 to about 20, and they might be great. But they're certainly there in the 1950s. The 1960s, 1970s onwards, farm labourers are very, very scarce, very thin on the ground. And indeed, what we talk about as the family farm, in terms of the labour needs of the farm, really is a family farm. So it's sons and daughters, we supply most of the farm labour, as well as the farmer and the farm wife. Incidentally, it's my impression that women had withdrawn from food labour. I can't date this. Some historians put it as really the First World War as the watershed. I'm not so sure about that. But in terms of women working, making hay, for instance, in the fields, except in very bad years, my recollection of the late, end of the 1950s, beginning of the 1960s, is that women had largely withdrawn from field labour. Of course, they were very involved in other enterprises, like off-grain, hens, egg production, turkey production sometimes, and so on. So they were more withdrawing in the direction of farmyard enterprises, and dairying, of course. Dairying is crucially important in terms of the grocery economy, and its butter is, you know, flowing outwards from the area to wider markets. So very quickly to sum up changes in the economy over time, and with the disappearance of agricultural labourers in the course of the 20th century, you've also pretty well a portion of the labour force, the disappearance of farmers as well. There's only a handful, as I understand it, of full-time farmers in the parish nowadays. Part-time farming is kind of halfway house between full-time engagement in farming and getting out of farming. And in the occupational structure, the occupations that have risen in Norton's are industry, Tipperary, spring water, Kelly's and Fontana's cement works until fairly recently. You have the professions and the service sector, public sector, private sector. So the occupational structure has been radically recast in the course of the 20th century. Now, I said I'd say a little bit about household structure and its evolution over time. Again, this comes straight from the 1911 census, because you can literally look into each household. It's wonderful people of the past. So in 1911, most household heads were married, a majority of households were nuclear family households, as we would expect nowadays. However, a large minority of households were extended, what we call extended family households. In other words, you might have a grandparent, an unmarried brother or sister of the household head, or an uncle, a niece or nephew. You know, some combination of those extra kinfolk cohabiting, co-residing within the household. I think I reckoned about 40%, this is from memory now, of the households in 1911 were extended family households. Nieces and nephews are particularly interesting because they're spattered round the parish, and typically, not invariably, but typically where you have a childless couple and might have a niece or a nephew kind of exported from, you know, a large family relative nearby in the parish. So various relatives they're found niches in different households. As one farmer once put it to me, it was a great way of getting a mouth away from the table, send son and daughter to live with a childless uncle around. The size of households was large, typically about five persons per household. And that's the average, so many households with 8, 9, 10 people in them. And very few people lived alone in 1911. Now, I don't have up-to-date information on the parish, though I don't think things have changed greatly from a survey I did in the 1980s, except the trends, I suspect, have become even more marked, more accentuated. But what I found in the 1980s was that households had evolved fairly radically over the previous 60 years or so, 60, 70 years. The typical household was a married couple with children, a nuclear family. You had a small number of extended family households, you know, extra kids living in, but not very many examples, and I suspect in the 21st century there were even fewer examples of that. There were quite a number of non-family households, well, sorry, I should say a minority of non-family households in 1911, not that many. It became more common in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, after that. The size of households was smaller, much smaller in the 1980s, and I suspect in the 21st century smaller still. Indeed, there's kind of a paradox or irony here. Someone pointed out to me, as families got smaller, houses in the area got bigger. So we got the timing wrong. And in the early 1980s, I suspect is the case today, far more people are living on their own. Now, that isn't by any means an exclusively Irish phenomenon. I was at a conference before Christmas, which was looking at single-person households living alone in Western Europe. And that seems to be a pattern right across Western Europe of a larger proportion of the population living in single-person households. And that could, of course, be because of choice, because of rising living standards, but there may also, almost certainly, is an issue of loneliness as well in relation to some of those solitary households. Now, to say a little bit about marriage, marriage is fundamental to social life, social reproduction in the countryside. And in the towns as well, of course, the towns typically also draw in lots of inward migration to keep things expanding. But marriage in, let's say, more traditional rural Ireland, in traditional Borrisoleigh, is rather more complicated than urban marriage, because it's bound up with inheritance of the home farm, the home place, and quite likely also care of the elderly. Indeed, if you look at some wills from the parish, which I've done, I mean, it's interesting how detailed some of the provisions are for, you know, who gets what, typically a single son inheriting, big contrast there with pre-family land, where in some regions, not all regions, you had what's called part of inheritance, the farm divided amongst, typically amongst the sons, two or three sons. That disappeared by the later 19th century in most parts of Ireland, few exceptions in the rest of Ireland. And so, Borrisoleigh in the 20th century, it's very much inheritance by a single son. They're making provisions for long inheriting sons and daughters. Daughters typically on the inherit land by default. I'm just reporting what it was, but now it might, you know, should have been. And yes, I think there may be a slide now that's relevant to the next bit. Oh, this is Laura Street in Borrisoleigh in 1922. No expense spared, just taken off the Borrisoleigh official website. And if we moved on, Brian. Yeah, we all have that slide. Yeah, this is aged marriage in Ireland. So in 1911, women married fairly late, 29 years, men significantly older, in their mid-30s when they got married. And placing that in a European context, that really is quite late. By 1960, particularly the 1950s, marriage age is beginning to creep downwards. So 27 for women, 31 for men. By 1970, Ireland's getting much closer to a European household. It's still a bit hardy, but women marrying typically in their 25th year, men in their 26th year. Interestingly there, you see the age gap on average between men and women is narrowing over time. So can you hear me if I go away from the microphone?
Yes.
Whereas in the early 20th century, the age gap between men and women, particularly of farmers and farmers' wives, can be quite wide. So in a way, men are getting together around more, so big changes in relation to men by 1970. Now, I could put in figures from the 1980s, 1990s, and 2011, but there isn't much point because the statistics are not really comparable because cohabitation before marriage or instead of marriage, one of the big other big social changes, 20th century Ireland, I mean 20th century Ireland, means that comparing marriage age with earlier periods doesn't make an awful lot of sense. And I suppose while we're talking about marriage and sexuality and cohabitation more generally, it's interesting to note that taboos like single parenthood and births outside marriage, which were never terribly high in rural Ireland, but they did increase during the course of the 20th century, low by European standards. Those taboos have disintegrated in virtually like last year's snow, if there was snow last year. You know what I mean? So the climate of opinion has changed radically. I must give a personal anecdote. I remember going to a meeting of the Irish Women's Movement in the Mansion House in Dublin in 1973. It was Mary Kenny, Mary Maher, and Anne McCafferty, others on the platform. And it was 1971, as I recall. And a woman in the audience got up as, in the general discussion and said, "I'm an unmarried mother." And it was, the whole was, Mansion House was packed. There was a spontaneous round of applause from all of the people there. It was quite a dramatic moment. Because this, in Ireland of the early 1970s, was a remarkable admission to making public. Nowadays, it's hardly worth noticing. Again, a major shift in attitudes to sexuality over time. And to me, I suppose in recent days we have I read in the papers our first openly gay minister. So when I was growing up, the idea of homosexuality and gay people wasn't mentioned. It wasn't simply that it was beyond the pale, it was almost inconceivable. And also, before the 1980s, I suppose, you have the extremely harsh treatment of unmarried mothers in various institutions. And that has all disappeared. The other social phenomenon that's disappeared as well, as far as I know, is marriage dowries. And I have... I have great interest in marriage dowries, but I find it all quite mysterious. Sorry, I don't find the existence of marriage dowries mysterious at all, because that's there for generations and generations in Irish society, Irish rural society, as it is in other European societies, and indeed as it is in India today. Marriage dowries are increasing rather than declining in significance, despite being illegal. What I find hard to understand is why marriage dowries faded out so quickly. Because they're there in the 1950s, and at the beginning of the 1960s, there were certainly examples from Borrisoleigh as from other rural communities of payment of marriage dowries. but they're relatively few when that just fades out. So the puzzle in a way is, why would a deeply embedded social institution such as the marriage dowry just kind of go over a precipice for a short space of time and disappear? We might have a chance to talk about that later. I should say my mother had a dowry, and I reckoned it was worth about just a bit slightly less than half the value of our farm at the time in Cronvo. And I remember asking her about this, and she changed my view of marriage dowries completely. She said she was delighted she had a dowry. It gave her a place, a status, a partnership in the farm, and she would have been deeply ashamed had she not had a dowry, marrying into a farm. And you've got a sense of that also, don't you? Remember, I was going to say that great awful film, The Quiet Man. It's perhaps great in many respects as well. The significance of the dowry as portrayed in that, which is reasonably close to the social reality of rural Ireland. So far from the marriage dowry signifying female subordination or powerlessness and so on, I think one can argue that, in fact, it gave women status, security, respectability, a whole range of issues. Now, I mentioned that age of marriage was late in Borrisoleigh as in Ireland in the early to mid-20th century. And as Ireland, rural Ireland, is at the extreme of the European experience, but it's even more extreme in terms of non-marriage. So I calculated a few days ago that amongst older males in Borrisoleigh in 1911, people who are extremely unlikely to ever get married, that one-third of older men had never married, and in all probability would never marry. demographers refer to this as remnant celibacy, which is a rather quaint term. And for women, for females, permanent celibacy rate was 26%. This is for Borrisoleigh. That's higher than the national average, but not much. It's broadly in the same ballpark. And I might illustrate that point by a bit of family history. Brian, can you? Yeah, this is my grandfather and grandmother. Moved on. This is my uncle Paddy in the centre. If I bought time, I could tell you this was a surprise birthday celebration when he was in his 80s. Complete disaster, into the whole night. You can see it's a bit happy there. If I was to give a talk, and Bobby Ryan, who was organising the whole thing, kept saying, don't talk yet, Paddy might thaw out a bit. He didn't, and I had no idea what I said at the end. I learned so much, and it was probably complete gibberish, but this is up across the campus, and we were drinking pints of Guinness. It's a great night, but the man at the centre didn't enjoy it at all. Anyhow, I want to go back in time to the late 1950s. I was in a holiday in that county, my grandfather's place. And the kitchen in Radcarlton, I just stick closely to notes here, is a very large, comfortable one. It's the late 50s, with a Victorian armchair for my grandfather. My grandfather was known as a boss. There was a great kitchen table and a side table where the food was prepared. There was a range, a sacred heart lamp, and an old clock on the wall with Roman numerals that looked down on us. Anyhow, at dinner time, typically, boss, as we called him, my grandfather, Paddy's father, sat at the head of the table, And Eileen was on his right-hand side. She spent most of the time moving to and from the range, bringing out the different courses. The workman, Willie Mangan, sat further down the long table, while Paul and I, my brother Paul, were further down again. Uncle Paddy sat to the left of Boss, but I remember even as a 12, 13, 14-year-old, whatever, being aware that while everybody else kind of faced into the table, Paddy had his chair turned sideways with his shoulder to the Boss. And he was kind of half turned away, and his gaze was always downwards towards his plate. And this is, it's a partly remembered conversation, it's certainly typical of what went on. Boss would say something like, "Are you ploughing the top field today?" "I am." "It's time to do it." Long pause from Paddy. "The cows need a bit of feeding." "They're all right." "They need some turnips to get ready for the spring." And then Paddy would lapse back into silence. Paddy didn't inherit the farm. He was the eldest son, didn't inherit the farm into his late 40s. And by then, he had obviously had to marry. He needed to have the farm to get married. It was a prerequisite in those days. And he never married. And it did strike me that Boss, you know, the great patriarch, actually it was great to ask him as a half-crown every now and then, but also could snuff on his, whatever you call that part of your hand, and get you to smell it, and sneeze like hell and fall around laughing. But it's one thing being grandchildren, it's a different thing being the son of the owner of a farm. And I suspect, you know, that kind of irksome relationship between father and inheriting son, with no alternatives, was, you know, kind of, well, in extreme cases, a humiliation that went on, you know, on many farms in rural Ireland. And you can, if you want to appeal to the literary sphere to follow up some of these themes, in this Patrick Kavanagh, The Green Fool, his novel, Terry Flynn, both strands, highly autobiographical, or perhaps even more vivid still, his long poem, The Great Hunger. Because The Great Hunger is an allusion to the Great Famine. It's also an allusion to sexual hunger in rural Ireland. Now, I mentioned my Aunt Eileen. She had an 11-year courtship and was well matched to a local farmer. But he, at the 11th hour, as it were, married another woman, less than a year. And she never married. So, and this is a fairly typical minority pattern in rural communities of an unmarried brother and sister, you know, co-residing in the home place. And eventually, perhaps a nephew inheriting the land. So she and Paddy, Eileen and Paddy, ran the house and farm. Now, I should say, in the case of Auntie Eileen, she led a very fulfilled life. She was financially independent in later life, fine looking woman. She had offers of marriage, made other offers of marriage, but she declined. I talked to her a little bit about this. And she said, "Never marry beneath yourself, especially women. We can never marry beneath ourselves." And that brings me to a wider theme, which is the importance of social class, which tends to get glossed over in rural communities. Because really, over the first three quarters or so of the 20th century, the great social divide was between farmers and labourers. And I've looked at the marriage records for Borrisoleigh. 85%, over 80%, the vast majority of farmers' daughters married farmers' sons. Now, I haven't looked at farm signs in those cases. I suspect if you did, you would find that, you know, daughters of large farmers married daughter sons from large farms and so on down. And looking at the marriage patterns of labourers in the parish, most labourers' daughters married labourers' sons. Now, that's true for about 70 or 80 years of the 20th century, but by the 1980s, those kinds of social restraints went declining. So you have a much, it doesn't change radically. I haven't looked at more recent period, and I suspect there's even greater social mobility. I could be completely wrong about that. Certainly by the 1980s, there's a fair amount of kind of marrying up and down the social scale. And I guess appearances became more important. Now, you might think, and it is the case, in fact, that economic considerations dominated in these marriage arrangements, particularly, of course, where dowry was concerned. And you remember the Percy French song, there's not a differ of a heifer between the Crotty and the plain. And I've actually documented one case, it's from Upper Church of Borrisoleigh, but it relates to the early 1960s and a dowry. But the marriage was delayed for a whole year because the farmer's son, wanted an extra £50 in dowry, and that had to be actually found before the marriage took place. Across the 20th century. And what you see, which is consistent with immigration, is, you know, a steep fall continuing right through until the Second World War. There's some missing observations there, I'm not sure. But, you know, undisputably a downward trend, which is what one would expect in terms of rural depopulation. Interesting thing, I think, is the stabilising of that in the 1950s. And that kind of shook me a bit, or caused me to wake up or whatever. Economic historians, which I suppose I'm one as well, would say about the 1950s, the decade of the 1950s in Ireland, that it's a decade of economic stagnation. It's a decade of massive rural exodus. And all of that is true. You know, if you look at GDP figures, there's very little gain between 1950 and 1958. The economy is in deep recession various points through that decade. But the odd thing, in a way, well, this is odd. I wouldn't have expected that. You'd expect that downward trend to continue. What's happening is that the marriage patterns are, I think the 1950s is a crucial decade. That's when age of marriage and the incidence of marriage or the frequency of marriage is just beginning to creep. Age of marriage is beginning to fall and the incidence of marriage, frequency of marriage is beginning to rise. So it's a decade of demographic transition as well. But also, many of you remember, not many are as old as I am. But I can remember in the 1950s, ESB poles marching across the countryside, you know, rural electrification, which had, it seems to me, huge social consequences. You had radios before rural electrification, but not in many households. So really, radio airing, as it then was, came into its own in the 1950s in rural areas. You had group water schemes, you know, sinks, tapped water, sometimes hot and cold water, toilets, bathrooms, just beginning to creep in the 1950s and then becoming more widespread in the 1960s. but also consumer durables that you then take for granted, like ranges, cookers, fridges, and so on. At the beginning of that consumer revolution, it seems to be in rural Ireland, is in the 1950s. Incidentally, as an aside, I remember it being a source of some merriment in our part of the parish, where clearly you could buy, you'd have to save up for one consumer durable at a time, and then others. But, it was a source of some merriment that one farmer got it. It was called a deep freezer, yeah. And they got a freezer before they got a toilet. Which led to the remark that they were more concerned about what went into it. So the 1950s is actually a decade of change, silent change by knowledge, and because then you see births rising and then falling in the later period of the 20th century. But of course, by then we're talking about deliberate family limitation, so it's not really comparable with earlier times. And if I had more time, I would also emphasize the very large families you get in some households in the early 20th century. 14 and 15 children. It's a good question. It's not quite a populist question. What do you think is the largest single determinant of family size? Some of them died. Indeed, there is some relationship between size of family and mortality, child mortality. There was not as close as you might think. The doctor in the parish, two of his children died, five or six. And you also see some quite large families, 10, 11, and all still living, all still alive. So there is a connection, but it's not as straightforward as we might think. Could I say a little bit about authority? I suppose some of the more subtle social changes during the 20th century. Now, you have a number of commentators on Irish life, British, American, some continental European, who write descriptions of life in Ireland, the late 19th, early 20th centuries, and most of them comment on the authoritarian nature of Irish society. So, and it's kind of a paradox there, I suppose, that people interested in political freedoms, as clearly was the case, seem to acquiesce quite readily in highly authoritarian relationships within Irish society. I mean, the obvious example is the Catholic Church, the clerical control of schooling, hospitals, old people's homes, to some extent universities, the National University of Ireland, reformatories, modern child homes, and so on, which led to some gross abuses, as we know. But we shouldn't forget that the Irish family, generalizing correctly, was also seemed to be highly authoritarian. My grandfather might well be a case in point. If he was here, I'm sure he'd disagree, but he's not. The patriarchal, the authoritarian or patriarchal father, I think is very much a feature of Irish rural families, and then fairly cold relationships sometimes between the generations, perhaps particularly between fathers and sons. And that, of course, has changed radically in recent decades. And indeed, when we're talking about institutionalized abuse and so on, we shouldn't forget the role of, it's right that sometimes the clergy get disproportionately blamed for what went on. Say all those unmarried mothers had, or often children had families, relatives, who didn't treat them particularly well. And if you think of the school system as well, I guess this is almost unknown now. I went to a two-teacher school, Ivy National School, some of my co-scholars are here tonight. And you can tell me if some of my recollections chime with yours, but we had a teacher from County Cork, in many respects a very good teacher in terms of explaining things and motivating students as well. I think I can only put it as a ferocious devotion to the Irish language, a devotion to Patrick Pearse and the United Ireland. He would tell us, he certainly told me, I don't know if he was, anyway, Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, Labour, sold out the Irish people, sold out the Republic. He at one stage, I remember, it was short-lived, but we were drilling, Clay, in the schoolyard, and he was a great admirer of Pearse's school, Scholae in Dublin. So I think we were replicating kind of Scholae. Where my recollection, I'd like to hear others, is that the drilling only lasted for a few weeks. I presume whether the parish priest or one of the parents objected. He didn't know what he was doing. He was also remarkably religious, and indeed in terms of the beatings in the school, which were prominent, the Irish language and religion were the hot points. And in later years, I sometimes referred to the school as a kind of republic of fear. And that's all been dismantled in terms of the educational system of the 21st century. Nobody could speak of it, the national school, the primary school, as a kind of republic of fear. And just to give perhaps a taste of this, I remember there was one boy in particular, Billy, many Billies, who the master seemed to have, had a real set on. I can't remember whether it was the Irish language or the catechism that Billy was singled out for special punishment. But the master had broken his stick a few days earlier, something else, presumably. So he sent another student out to get a stick. There's a rural school, so lots of trees and branches round about. And the other student or scholar, as he was called, came in with a rather feeble-looking stick. The master roared at him, "Get out of here! If you don't bring in a proper stick, I'd use it on you as well." He's left there for 10, 15 minutes or whatever, just awaiting his fate. And yet that's something that has absolutely disappeared from Irish society. And indeed, many of those structures, those authoritarian structures, from church to education to the family itself, it seems to me, many of those structures have been dismantled. So we've had a kind of silent social revolution in relation to those issues. Now, I didn't check what time I started. How long have I been ranting on? Do you want another 5 minutes, or would you like? Yeah. Can I just itemise the sources of information? Oh yes, sorry. This is important. This is Eddie Ryan, captain of the Tipperary team. And Ray Christie Ridge, you can say that. But I think it, in a way, that image sums up the relationship between church and society at a moment in time, the early 1960s. I don't know, just perhaps another anecdote in relation to Eddie Ryan. It's Eddie and Tim Ryan, the Tipperary team, and Tim is the father of Bobby Ryan, Nathan Ryan, who starred in the late 80s, 1980s, early 1990s. I don't know if it's this game, I need to research this picture, but I remember asking Eddie when he was Tipperary captain, it was a Munster final with Cork. Tipperary were leading by, I think it was 2 points, going into the last few minutes. And Eddie, as the captain, suddenly realised that he was going to have to give a victory speech. A lovely man, gentle, rather shy, well, it was Norman's gentle, but anyhow, dreaded the thought of giving the victory speech. However, the day was saved because Christy Ring got a goal in the last minute. I said to Eddie, God, you must have been really disappointed. He said, no, I was delighted. Good day, Eddie. Oh, no, sorry, there is one before that, is there?
Yeah.
Oh, we can leave it on that for just a moment. I did, yeah, I was going to literally just headline what I think are the sources of social change. I think it's changes in the international economy, technological change sweeping Western society, the global economy as well, of course, and including therein some of the less remarked on examples of technical change, of which I think we appeal in terms of status of women in society is very often forgotten in that great fertility revolution which you get in the later 20th century and so on, is a product of that technological change. Cultural change from abroad, of course, sweeping into Ireland, also cultural change from within, because again, one of the great changes in the later 20th century is the much greater emphasis on education. Formal education, second level and third level. So we were a highly educated population capable of generating some of its own social and cultural change. I'm thinking of writers like Clement Tobin, Shane Sweeney, Michael Longley, my favourite poet, Paul Durkin, favourite playwright, Brian Free, favourite rock star, Bob Geldof. You two, I don't understand how you can put them. Traditional musicians and singers, riverdance and so on. And also the role of the state in Irish society in promoting quite a number of these. And finally, the rise of individualism. Now, I've talked about various forms of social change across the 20th century. There are continuities as well. One, and I'll just mention two, there are others. One is the sense of community. All that stuff about the demoralisation of rural society, I think, by and large, was for the birds. And the second is the sense of humour. Can I, just in relation to community feelings, I mean, there are many instances of communal life that have disappeared. You know, Corvia, post-visiting, storytelling, and so on. That's largely gone. Certain forms of mutual aid have gone, such as working together, in the bog at threshings, saving the hay and so on. And that's all got replaced by television, farm mechanisation, contractors and the like. But, you know, that is life, it's full of change. There are still big communal celebrations and perhaps the preeminent one is funerals. Funerals are as alive today as ever. And there are other social events that mobilise huge sections of the community, be it sport or religious services or whatever. So in terms of debates about rural Ireland and notions of the death of rural Ireland, I can do no better than paraphrase Mark Twain. Reports of my recent death have been badly exaggerated. And that's also true of rural Ireland for the last half century or more. Rural Ireland we know today, and the Borrisoleigh we know, would be barely recognisable to people at the beginning of the 20th century. But, you know, rural Ireland adapts and changes, which is surely a sign of life rather than death. And if I can give you a tiny bit of continuity of humour, I had several examples, I just used one actually. And this is taken from the end of the 1950s. It's about a debate about new time versus old time in Borrisoleigh. The parish priest at the time was Canon Davin. And Canon Davin had a referendum on the question of time change in the late 1950s. I remember the ballot papers from my parents from national school. Now, it was well known that Canon Davin was very fine. It was well known that he favoured old time and had no time for newfangled new time or summer time. So the referendum duly took place, the people voted, and a bit like the results of some Communist Party elections, the results were never made known. But surprisingly, old time continued. It seems the people had no right to be wrong. And that gave rise to a certain amount of annoyance, no doubt, but actually also a degree of agreement, I think. Canon Davin was a decent man, and the next year he adopted a compromise. Borrisoleigh would have a time halfway between the date of the act. Not only surprisingly, there was great confusion. People asked, what time was the 11 o'clock bus at Borrisoleigh? Was it 10:30 or 11:30? Or indeed, was it 11 o'clock? People turned up for funerals half an hour late, or half an hour early. While the school seemed to be in another time zone, Fantan National School, which is in the parish of Borrisoleigh, was on a new time, or summer time. And his young go-ahead teacher, Nick Small, who's the size here today, Borrisoleigh's national school, that's in the town, village, was on old time. So confusion reigned. Canon Davin bound to the tide of modernisation eventually. Perhaps I'll just add one other very quickly. I mentioned the legendary Canon Davin. He incidentally was the one who reconverted or reconciled Dan Green to the Catholic Church shortly before Dan Green died in the Wicklow nursing home in 1969. How do I know that? Because Nick Small, who I've just mentioned, the headmaster in the boys' school, told me he drove the canon from Borrisoleigh up to the nursing home in Wicklow in 1969 for that purpose. My understanding is that, I'm not sure of this, you know, Breen and Davin came from roughly the same part of South Tipperary. And finally, I was an altar boy with Canon Davin in Ireland Church in the 1950s, and occasionally Canon would talk to us. Generally, it didn't bother complaining, which was fine by us as we fought over delivering the bell to senators. And he was generous to us at Christmas and Easter time. Anyhow, he called us into the inner sanctum before Mass one morning. Probably had a few minutes to kill. What does the name Kennedy mean? He asked me. I don't know, Father. What is it in Irish? Oh, Canada, I said. That's it. Now, there are two meanings of the title of the word. One is the armoured heads. The other is the ugly heads. And he laughed and laughed. And we laughed as well, of course. Not quite sure whether what we were laughing at, or whether we should be laughing at. So, the humour continues. Should I will? Can we show the final slide? Yeah. Thank you very much.